Billy Mitchell, Video Game Player of the Century, and you're watching Nerd Buffet.
Hello everyone, thanks for joining us on the Nerd Buffet podcast, where we believe a balanced diet is pizza in each hand. My name's Tommy.
And I'm Jake. I love the pizza ideas, man. I love that. I think anybody can get behind it.
We just had pizza, too.
Yeah, we did. And now I'm hungry for pizza again. I think anybody can get behind it besides the Olympics athletes, because I remember seeing something like for the last Olympics, like 4 years ago, about like, oh, I haven't ate a dessert in 10 years because I'm in the Olympics.
And what
I'm
a
like,
terrible way to live.
Yeah, I guess the gold medal's great and all, but I'd rather have a slice of pizza.
They're always biting the gold medals, so like, are they hoping they're made of chocolate?
No, I think that's to test if it's really gold.
Oh, I thought maybe they're like, oh, hopefully this is chocolate because I haven't had it in 8 years.
Which I don't understand. They're like, oh, I better make sure this is gold so I can sell it.
If it was gold, they would bite right through it and ruin their metal because it's soft.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I guess I don't understand, because wouldn't you just want to keep the metal? Wouldn't it be a little bit more valuable than selling it? I don't know.
It's an old tradition, and photographers want that picture. That's why it happened.
Oh, I didn't even know that was a thing. I thought you were saying like some people do that. Didn't know it was a tradition, so. Getting on to more nerdy things, because that's probably the most that you'll hear from us talking about sports and athletics. We had a lot of things going on. We actually watched more things than we played this week. Tom's Xbox One is still broken?
Still dead.
Oh, God, that's so sad. The only thing that I did get to play this week, because like I said, we've been watching a lot of things, not a lot of time to play games. I played the Titanfall 2 open beta. I guess it's called a tech demo right now. They're taking a lot of feedback, actually, right now with changes in gameplay. If you played, and you did play a mm-hmm. lot of the first game, it feels a lot like the first game. For me, I think the balance is a little bit better. I get about 2, sometimes 3 Titanfalls a game,
mm-hmm.
whereas last game I was getting them like 5 or 6 times, unless I was just dominating everyone
and
never died.
Is it harder to earn them? You have to get more experience to get them, or?
See, all I did in the other game, honestly, I think I've played every game mode. Some modes may be only one game total, but I played attrition all the time.
Mm-hmm.
There's a new one, and I've only played this one game mode. I think it's called bounties or something like that.
Yeah.
Basically, it's not quite kill confirmed, because kill confirmed, you know, you, in Call of Duty, you would kill the person, pick up their medal, and then bring it back to your base. In this bounty mode, you get money for kills on grunts, on specters, and then more money for killing other enemy pilots.
Yeah.
Only at the end of waves, because there are AI waves that come through too, and there are also AIs like bosses, like big mechs that'll drop down that can be killable by either side,
like Halo 5 Warzone or whatever.
Yes, Warzone in Halo 5. Only at the end of waves can you go cash in your money, so it's a little bit more risk reward based of like, hey, I'm on an awesome streak right now, but do I really want to go try to fight the next guy and get killed? Because when you get killed, you drop half of the money.
I heard a lot of people on the other team are like just camping at the other team's like base.
To
kill them as they come back.
And it's part of the strategy, and I don't think that they should fix anything with that, because that is a really good strategy, yet it can be a bad strategy too, because while you're sitting there waiting, they can be out scoring, you know, getting money.
More points, yeah.
It's not very hard. I learned that people do that. It's not very hard to just wait a second and look around, throw a grenade in, and then go in and deposit your money. another, again, there's a lot of counterbalancing going on. You don't just walk up and press X and drop all of your money at once. You have to stand there and hold X, and your money slowly drains out of you. I think that's really cool. There are only two types so far. I'm only like level four because I've only played like five matches. There are only two types of Titans allowed so far. They don't have the weapons that I'm used to. I use the quad rockets.
Well, if it's a beta test, they're probably not putting the old ones in.
Right. It's not a full game.
Testing the new ones.
Yeah. And I think it's perfect the way they're doing it right now. I know, of course, there are things that they want to fix. I haven't found anything in my play time that I'm like, oh my god, this needs fixed now.
It's got to be pretty close to being done, though.
Yeah.
Now.
Yes.
Because they're already past beta, I'm sure.
Yes.
A lot of times they put out these open betas, and they're not real betas. You know, they're more demos. They just call them betas.
Right. I think they are, because I know I read at least one article that... I didn't really read all through the article. I read the headline, I should say, of some fans being mad about something, and that the company, yeah, I think it's EA makes it.
Respawn.
All
the old Infinity Ward people
right,
went to go Respawn.
Right. That's why I was thinking EA.
I think it might be published
by EA. It is published by EA. A lot of people were crying about something, but I certainly haven't found out what it was because I like it.
I'm sure there's still time for them to go back and change whatever they need to before it goes gold and before they start printing discs.
Yeah.
So.
I definitely think if one thing is unbalanced, I think it's called a Scorcher type of Titan. He shoots, it's like a single shot reload, mm-hmm. And it takes a while. Oh, I remember what it was. People were complaining that the Titans are not very mobile.
Oh.
But I'm like, these are the big mech Titans.
They're like the Atlas.
You have the two giant Titans right now. I learned in the first game that I played forever with the big guy, and then I switched to the medium guy. Once I switched to the small one, the small Titan, I was unstoppable in that game. I like 90% of my games were no kill, no deaths,
mm-hmm.
because anytime you're in trouble, boom, 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 get out of there. You don't just reload, your health doesn't regenerate like it did in the other one. You have to go pick up battery packs.
Yeah.
And you can't be in your Titan to pick it up. You have to jump out and get it and then bring it back in. Or if your buddy has a Titan and you don't and you're carrying a battery pack, when you would jump onto the Titan like you did in the last game, you'll put the battery pack in and it fills their health up. Really cool thing with that regarding that whole thing too. In the old game, when you jumped on an enemy Titan, you would pull up their battery pack and shoot it to destroy them.
Just shoot the heck out of it.
And in this game, it's not so easy to destroy their Titan, because when you jump on the first time, you rip their battery pack out, which puts it in your inventory.
Yeah,
and like
you start carrying it.
Yeah. At death, you always drop the battery pack, and you can pick it up, friend or foe.
Someone else can pick it up. That's cool. I didn't know if they would just explode or what.
Nope, the battery packs are always always there for the rest of the game.
What I'm looking forward to in Titanfall 2 is that the Ronin type Titan. He's got a sword.
Oh yeah, that looks really cool.
Melee.
I will say I forgot about saying that until you brought that up. The kills were really cool when they're out of health and you punch them. It was really cool in the first game. Like, you would rip the guy out and just throw him and they'd die.
Smash,
rip their arms off and hit them with it. They're even more cool in this game because it does the same thing where you're invulnerable while you're doing it, but it goes in the third person. So you see
both Titans.
You watch both Titans. You watch yourself wreck the other guy pretty much.
That's cool.
What
I've been playing... since my Xbox is broke, I got Luigi's Mansion Dark Moon for the 3DS.
Yeah, I really loved the first game.
I never got a chance to play the first game, and I'm disappointed because I really like the DS version.
It took me... the first time I played it, it took like... I rented it, and I stayed up all night and beat it. I played it again when I was, in senior year of high school, probably. Many years after I beat it again, and I was better at games,
mm-hmm.
and... better with using a GameCube controller. Took me like 4 hours to beat the whole game. It's not long at all. I doubting that's the case with this one.
I don't know. I'm, like I said, I'm not very far into it, but I'm liking what I've played so far. You gotta tilt the DS to shoot up and down.
Oh, really? Does that get annoying at all?
When I first saw it, I'm like, oh, I don't like this, but it's not, you don't have to tilt it that far.
In the GameCube version, I guess, obviously there was no tilt controls, but you would start vacuuming the ghost. You would have to shine a light on the ghost mm-hmm. to stun him.
Yep.
And then you would vacuum by flicking, whichever way you're facing, you would flick backwards from the C-stick the opposite direction, and you would pull him. And you could also throw him up and down to slam him to stun him while you're pulling. Sounds like it's pretty cool. I mean, do you know much about the game so far? Like, what's the story?
The story is all the ghosts are peaceful. And Professor Egad is, like, studying them because they're peaceful. There's a dark moon in the sky. That's why it's called Dark Moon, mm-hmm. a crystal. And that, for some reason, permeates and makes the ghost non-hostile. Well, somebody shoots a laser into the moon and breaks it, and the pieces scatter everywhere, and all the ghosts go hostile again. So you gotta capture them and then try to find all the pieces of the moon to fix it.
Huh. Is it the same thing, like it all happens in one night in the mansion?
I think there may, because it has like an overworld map, so there may be more than one location to go.
Really?
To.
Okay. That's the one thing that I kind of hoped for in the first game, but it wasn't like that. The whole game took place in Luigi's mansion that I think he supposedly inherited from somebody. It's been a long time since I played it. But at the end, you start fighting Bowser. But when Bowser's head falls off and floats around, you figure out that it's actually a machine shaped to look like Bowser, and it's King Boo controlling the machine that's been mm-hmm. doing all this all along. So maybe
I think it may have been King Boo that shot the laser.
Oh, like you have a hunch, or you think you might have saw it happen?
I think I saw King Boo.
Okay.
I'm not for sure. Like I said, it was kind of a long opening, and I got bored watching it.
Right. Well, let us know how it is. I definitely want to play it sometime. Maybe I'll borrow it from you after you beat it. Anything else you've been playing?
I got, again, on 3DS, I finally got Animal Crossing New Leaf. I like it so far. If anyone plays it and you have a town, send me your friend codes. I'll visit your town, water your plants.
I could never get into that game because I'm not going to water your damn plants for you.
Yeah, you don't have to. It's weird because everything takes place in real time. So if someone says, I'll see you tomorrow, they literally mean tomorrow. Huh. You can time travel, as it's called in the manual.
Yeah.
By changing the game time in the game.
Yeah.
To tomorrow or yesterday or whatever, and go to that time then. But that's kind of a pain, I think. I wish it was more like Harvest Moon, where if you're done for the day, you go to bed and
wake up the next day. Yeah. So real time. So you have to wait for all of your plants to be planted.
There's really not even plants in Animal Crossing. It's more like if you wanted to go to one of the shops, it's like, oh, we're closed tonight, and you have to wait till tomorrow to go to the shop. So it's kind of annoying that way, but
I've never played an Animal Crossing. Is that something you think I'd like?
I don't know. I don't think so, actually.
No, bored?
Yeah.
Oh, I see. All right. Well,
I also picked up Legend of Zelda Wind Waker HD.
Oh, that's good. I reported several weeks ago that I was playing it. I took a break. Just, I don't know why. I think it's just playing other games and stuff. It's not bad by any means. I've been meaning, if you start playing it, that'll like get me to be like, oh, I better beat it before Tom does so that he doesn't spoil anything. Not that you're notorious for spoiling things, but if you start talking about it, of course, I'll be like, oh, yeah. I gotta play this again.
I haven't even opened it yet, but soon.
It's great.
I never played the first one, like the original.
You haven't played a full Zelda game before?
No, I've never beat a Zelda game in my life.
Comments section, is this the best game for him to start playing Zelda on? I would say it might be, but I haven't beat the whole game either. I've beat almost every other Zelda game. I would say, out of all the games that I've played, I would actually recommend Link to the Past for the first Zelda game.
Which I also have and haven't played.
Never played, right. Oh, makes me sad to hear. I had a homework assignment this week. It was to watch Stranger Things. If ever there's homework like this to do again, I would love to do homework. I wish all homework was like this. This is the best thing that I've ever been assigned to do. It was so good. There were only 8 episodes.
Perfect,
why?
Perfect time.
I want more now. You know?
I think it was a perfect length to watch all of them. Definitely end up wanting more, though. There's unanswered questions.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure they're having a second season. I bet
they've announced it.
Okay. I bet the networks that passed up on it are kicking themselves.
Just throwing up. Just still, right now, just still in the bathroom, just throwing up.
It took them a while to find a place to have this, you know, before Netflix, like, yeah, sure, we're putting everything else out. We'll give you a chance.
Yeah, this show was great in many factors. The first thing that I caught myself really enjoying was the lighting, the sound, the visuals, the camera shots. Everything made it look like it was a show that was from the 80s. It looked like a series that I had missed out on for 30 years.
Yeah, I watched it with Tanya, and she thought that it was an old show. She was like, what's up with this? And I was like, the first, 10 minutes of the show or whatever, she's like, this really looks like an old show. I'm like, yeah, they did a good job.
Mm-hmm. Like the house, the all of the sets that they used in the movie, or in the shit movie, the show made it look like something I remember from my very early childhood. The way my grandma's house looked back in like home movies.
Yeah.
And from my earliest memories.
I can see that with the wallpaper and the couch. And
Mike's house looked like, is my grandma's house.
It was like a Goonies TV show.
Yeah. I would say the Goonies mixed with just a little bit of E.T. and a lot of the X-Files is the best way of explaining this. If you don't like any of those things, still watch the show.
Stop watching our show and go watch Stranger Things.
Right. I don't know anyone that said they didn't like this show. Actually, most of the time when I said... Because, of course, when you see something that's truly good, you want to go say, hey, have you seen this? Let's talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone at work that I talked to said, hey, have you seen Stranger Things? Or, hey, I've got a show for you to watch. It's called Stranger Things. All of them were like, duh, I watched it a month ago when it came out. Where were you? So I felt kind of bad. I was a little bit shamed this week with the amount of people that actually said that to me. Did you have anything... that you like favorite things in this show, like characters or episodes that stood out to you, scenes?
I really liked the opening with the kids playing Dungeons and Dragons.
That's so foreshadowing.
Yeah.
On the rest of the show. I really... Do we want to go into spoilers at all?
It's been a month.
Okay, you've been warned. If you have not seen this show, please stop... Nerd Buffet as much as we want you to watch this episode, because we have other things, a really good movie that we're going to be talking about later that I really want to talk to you about, but if you've not seen the show, stop it right now, watch the show, come back and watch this fantastic episode of Nerd Buffet.
It'll only take you 8 hours.
Yeah, technically.
That's it.
You can come back tomorrow if you binge it. What else are you doing on Sunday? We all know that church attendance in the last 4 years, or no, since the last census, has gone down 63%, I think, based upon a Pew poll. So you're not going to church on Sunday. Just go watch Stranger Things.
We're not trying to shame you to go into church. No. As a matter of fact, I don't want anyone to go to church. So
that's terrible, dude. For the record, go to church. If you're still going to church, or if you feel like going to church, go to church. Church is great. Then go watch Stranger Things after you have dinner with your family.
I don't believe in organized religion, so...
Wow, we're getting so far off, and we said we weren't going to talk about politics. Now we're talking about religion. This is awful. This is all falling apart.
It is. Back to Stranger Things.
Yes.
The opening with the kids playing Dungeons & Dragons was awesome. I really liked
The Demogorgon.
The Demogorgon.
That thing, I've never heard that name before in my life, but like now if anybody says Demogorgon, I'm like, Jesus, where? Like, I don't want to fight that.
And it was cool how they related their experiences in Dungeons & Dragons into their real life. Like, they're like, okay, this is the Demogorgon, you know. And
the bad guy was the Demogorgon.
And they were talking about the alternate dimension.
The upside down.
The upside down, but they were like, this is like the Veil of Shadows.
Yeah.
You know, it exists in the same place we do, but you can only see it in certain circumstances. And
I said this a second ago, but the first thing that I really picked up on, besides the whole 80s vibe of the show, is in the first scene when talk about foreshadowing, the Demogorgon was there, and he says, boom! 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 He's getting closer, you know, boom! Whenever the Demogorgon was in a scene in the entire series, that was the music. Mm-hmm. It was like, gong, gong, you know what I'm saying? Did you catch that, like, connection?
No, I didn't.
Yeah, rewatch it. It's really cool that they did that. I wonder if they made, when they were, like, writing the score to the show, or at least the Demogorgon theme, if they saw that scene and then they wrote the music, or if they wrote the music and they had the kid do that. Something that I really liked. My favorite character, I almost want to say L or 11, because she was great in not speaking very much, but the cop really took it for me.
He was my favorite, the sheriff of the town.
He was actually, I don't think he was a sheriff, I think he was the chief of police. Which Hopper, Jim Hopper. He was really good in the show. At the beginning, he kind of, like, you can tell there's more to him than what you're seeing. Of course, he has the typical cop thing of, like, waking up in the morning and smoking and drinking and going to work.
He's a small-town cop, so he knows everyone, which I really thought was cool. They didn't have to go into letting everyone know, but obviously, Winona Ryder's character and him were in school together.
Yeah.
And I think it was hinted that they even had a relationship at one time.
Yeah, it really feels like either there's some sort of, I don't want to say, should I say tension there?
Yeah. I think they did, maybe there was a one-night stand or something, because it seems like Hopper
I would say that more than like
but a they maybe dated in high school or something or shortly after. But it's a small town, and you know how small towns are. People rarely get away from them, so.
Right.
Everyone in the town knows each other, so it's really a big deal when, what's-his-name disappears.
Will?
Yeah, when Will disappears, the whole town gets together and looking for him, you know, and it's really... So, it's cool how it captures small towns, too, back in the 80s.
And there's plenty going on. It's not just the story about the kids and the sheriff. There's also an underlining story with... and it's weird because, it's just a few families that are involved, but like you said, it is the whole town that in one way or another is in on it. One of the boys, Mike, who I would say is one of the main characters of the show.
He is the main character.
Yeah, you think so? Okay. Mike's older sister, Nancy, kind of has this relationship, and it feels like you're almost crossing genres to, like, romantic, like, I don't want to say 16 Candles, but like an 80s romance type of movie.
Like a John Hughes movie.
Yeah. And that crosses over from starting as a John Hughes movie to where they all meet up at the end in this sci-fi movie. So I didn't think I was going to like that story as it started, but... not so much that it had to be sci-fi for me, but all of the little beats and motions that it hit worked.
And it all worked in together with Will's brother, you know.
Is it John, his name?
Am I thinking? I don't remember, but with Will's brother getting tangled up with those high school kids, he's kind of a loner, you know, and he gets picked on by these other kids.
Yeah.
So there's kind of that whole type of thing going on.
Again, typical 80s movie where there's, and my high school experience wasn't necessarily like this, where there was like, there are the jocks and then the outside kids, and then the jocks were able to just beat up everyone else. I didn't consider myself a jock, but I never got beat up in school. I don't think that that would have ever happened just because of the crew I hung out with, you know?
I used to get picked on when I was in, like, middle school.
And then they just figured out you're three times their size.
Well, one summer I grew, like, 7 inches.
Yeah.
So then I stopped getting picked on.
They're like, Tommy, my friend. I don't know, man. There was a lot of stories in this show, like I said. The kids have their own, and it does feel like you're watching a very competent show throughout. Because it doesn't just... You don't see... Sorry, I'm going to take a stab, but... Something I hate about, and I don't know how I got to this kind of comparison, but The Walking Dead. Recent seasons of The Walking Dead, you'll go to a character that you absolutely don't care about, and you'll have to see a whole episode of this character. I don't care. I want to see everyone, like it's supposed to be.
This Stranger Things did a really good job of letting you know what everyone was doing.
At the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Almost like it was written as an 8-hour movie.
It really was, and it was edited that way, too. It was edited to where I was never bored with one story, because, you know, if you didn't edit it right and you stuck me with the kids the whole episode, I would have been like, come on, I want to see what the sheriff's doing.
Yeah.
Where's his progress at? Or where's this romance story at? Just like everyone else. The sheriff was my favorite part, so maybe you could do a whole episode of the sheriff, but... We don't want that. We want it the way it was here. I'm going to say that this is one of the better shows that I've seen in a very long time. Only 8 episodes, so it's hard to say that that this is the most perfect thing ever made. But I am fully on board with the second season.
I think it's probably... I haven't seen Orange is the New Black, but I think this is the best original show on Netflix.
I like Daredevil quite a bit. Jessica Jones was almost Daredevil for me, but I was one of those few people that said Daredevil was better than Jessica Jones. But this does beat for me Daredevil just by a hair. I don't even know. Are you gonna challenge yourself to rate this show?
4.5.
That sounds fair. I think that I'll stick at 4.5. It's hard. It's hard for me to give a perfect 5. I don't know why. Maybe I should give it a 5.
For me, a perfect score, I think I told you, it means it's...
You have to cry at some point.
Well, no. In that case, Despicable Me would have been a 5 for me, but...
that might be, like... I wouldn't say that that's a something I need, but It was as close to perfect as you could get, I think.
Yeah. To me, a 5 is just not as good as Star Wars, but almost.
Almost. Okay.
That's how I feel.
Well, I've got some news to drop if we're done talking about this show, then.
We're done with Stranger Things. Go watch it. It's good.
Yes. Go watch
it. It's good.
You said a 5 counts as something that's almost as good as Star Wars, but not quite. I saw a movie... that you didn't get to see yet. And I am giving the first Nerd Buffet 5 out of 5 to this movie.
What?
Yeah. Kubo and the Two Strings. It makes me so upset to see that this movie is not making any money. Because the words instant classic, I think, nowadays, and especially in the last 10 or 15 years, are completely overused.
Yeah, that's for sure.
But I'm not one of the people that uses... the words instant classic. Have you ever heard me say instant classic before today?
No.
Kubo and the Two Strings is an absolute instant classic. If you have never heard of this movie, watch the trailer.
It's not your fault if you haven't heard of this movie, because I don't think a lot of money has been spent in the marketing.
No, it hasn't.
I've seen the trailer, and I had to search for it.
Yes. The making of, I think, is where the money went into, because by no stretch of your imagination could you say that this was cheap to make. Watch the featurette of the movie on YouTube if you want to even like think about it or to compare what I'm talking to this.
We can even link the trailer.
We absolutely could do that. It is a stop animation movie. and no expense was spared in any of the set pieces.
I didn't even know it was stop motion until I watched the featurette. Like, when I saw the trailer, there's no way I knew it was stop motion, because it's that good, the animation anyway. It's the same company that did Coraline. And I liked Coraline quite a bit. It's not my favorite movie, but I enjoyed what I saw. It was creepy as hell.
This movie wasn't necessarily creepy. This is not spoiling anything. Kubo is the son of two magic users. One of them is Hanzo, and the other is his mother, that you don't get a lot of information about her. She talks about Hanzo a lot. About every day before he goes to bed, she tells him tales of Hanzo the samurai. The mother can use magic with like a little guitar thing that she has, and Kubo uses it to like, he has origami. He'll like play his guitar, and his origami will fly around and shape to whatever he wants to do. The story that he tells is of Hanzo going to fight this mystical creature. Like, I don't even want to get into who he's fighting, because that's kind of a spoiler thing. But he has to pick up three pieces of equipment: a sword, a chess piece, and a helmet. So it's kind of an adventure for him and his friends he meets along the way to get these three quest piece items. And it does feel kind of like a video game, in a way, of going to search.
You have to get these things before you can fight the boss.
Right, and that's the plot of the movie. But please don't undermine this at all in me saying it, or simplify it, because it is such a like mystical, like, I don't even know what other words to explain it.
Pretty good voice cast, right? It's got Matthew McConaughey.
Yes.
Was it Gwyneth Paltrow?
No, I don't think Gwyneth Paltrow is in it. The what's her name that played Furiosa from Charlize Theron.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. George Takei is in a very small role. I don't know why he wasn't in it more. He really should have been. But McConaughey was the one thing I thought in the movie that would get annoying.
Mm-hmm.
He was my favorite character by the end of the movie. Just shout out to that. Tell me if you agree, if you do end up seeing this movie. McConaughey was great. You know what movie I really felt like so many times while I was watching this? I felt like the first time I ever watched Aladdin when I was watching this. So if that I don't even want to say nostalgia, because it's a new movie, but it really brought in a nostalgia factor of like, I'm a kid again, and this is something that I'm going to rewatch and
watch. It takes you back to that time when you were a kid and you saw these new things and you're like, oh, this is awesome.
Yeah.
So Kubo, go watch it. I'm going to go watch it this week, I think.
If you go, let me know, because I really want to go see it again.
Okay. We also saw a really good movie last week, Don't Breathe.
Yes. It took me all the way until the last 20 minutes to realize, because I didn't know the actor's name even until the credits, that bad guy in this movie was the same bad guy as in Avatar.
Yeah. Stephen Lang.
Yeah. What else has he been in, or what else is he?
Soon to be Cable in the Deadpool movie.
Did they announce that?
That's not confirmed, but he's...
That would be awesome.
He's one of the names that gets thrown around quite a bit as Cable.
That actually would work. He
didn't even have a name. He's the blind man.
He looks like he'd be Cable.
Yeah.
I mean, he looks like Cable, straight up. Does he have interest in it, or is it just something that the internet wants him to do?
I don't know if he does or not. I know the internet loves that idea, though.
Okay. Well, I think he would be on board. I mean, he was an Avatar. That was kind of a nerd movie of sorts. Not that he was in it just because nerds, but...
He doesn't get a lot of work, I don't think, so I think he'd be in...
No, because I haven't seen him in anything besides those two movies, Avatar and Don't Breathe, unless I'm missing something here or there.
I feel like he was in something else sci-fi, like maybe Battlestar or something.
Nah, I don't know.
I don't know either. One of those nerd things I don't watch. But what'd you think of the movie overall?
Man, you know, I thought... I actually was really excited going into this one because...
See, I didn't have any... I saw the trailer and I thought it was going to be scary. Like a scary jump movie. And so I wasn't real...
I jumped a lot in that movie.
But I mean, it wasn't like Insidious.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't a gore scare movie.
No, it was. It was more suspenseful than scary, I think.
Yeah.
And I, like I said, I don't like scary movies, to like the new ones. You know, I like the old ones.
I haven't liked many scary movies since like the old Michael Myers movies.
Halloween's my favorite.
Me too.
Scary movie series.
I liked the Halloween remake, and then the second remake, Halloween 2, until the last 5 or 10 minutes of it. Then I didn't like it. But that aside, the last scary movie I watched before this, if you want to call it scary movie, whatever you want to call it, horror genre, horror slash suspense, was The Conjuring 2. Once I watched that movie, I left the theater with Savannah and I said, hey, maybe this genre isn't dead for me.
Yeah.
Because I actually really liked The Conjuring Part 2. I liked it actually even better than 1 and Insidious, all the Insidious movies. I thought it was the best of that filmmaker's movies. So I saw this trailer while I was in Missouri in Kirksville the first time. And I said, I'm going to go see this movie because this is like the first horror slash suspense movie that I've cheered for the serial killer since Michael Myers.
Yeah, cheering for the bad guy because he seems just like...
In my eyes, he wasn't a bad... Well, something happens in the movie that he's definitely a bad guy of sorts.
Of sorts.
But
he's messed up in the head for sure.
But as far as his relationship with the three, like,
the main 20-somethings
in this movie, he's the good guy to me.
Yeah, as far as his relationship between the people who break into his house, he's the good guy in that situation. But other situations, not so much.
Because in most of these types of movies, it's teenagers or 20-somethings trying to have sex, and the murderer in the movie, the bad guy in the movie, is trying to kill him because they had sex. You know, that's how Freddy was, that's how Jason was, that's kind of how Michael Myers was, mm-hmm. arguably.
In that time, in the 70s, it was kind of, well, we've got to have our sex in here to sell it,
yeah.
but then we're going to murder him. So.
And this movie really wasn't like that. They wanted to break into his house because, for some reason or another, don't want to get into spoilers because it did just come out.
He had a large amount of money in the house.
Yes, and these kids usually break in and just steal items. They don't steal cash or anything. I think it was over $10,000. Is a
the main male character. I'll say I don't remember his name at all.
No, I don't remember.
He had figured it out where if they don't steal cash, they only steal items under $10,000. It's just robbery. It's not grand larceny.
Right. Grand larceny is up to 10 years or 10 years minimum.
10 years minimum. Yeah.
So he was pretty smart about that. Many other aspects of his burglary it was really freaking stupid throughout the whole movie. I was thinking, hey, I've seen Daredevil before, so you guys should be a little bit quieter since he can't see anything. He probably can hear a little bit more because he probably
in this universe, Daredevil doesn't exist.
Right.
I think.
Right.
Or these kids never heard of it.
Or they're just stupid.
Yeah, that too.
It was really cool seeing the whole thing of the lights do go out at one point in the movie. That's not a spoiler because that's in the trailer.
Not to be confused with the other movie in theaters. Lights out.
I had a bad time with figuring out which one was which because I saw the trailer and I didn't remember what the movie was called, and I kept telling Savannah, "Hey, want to go see that Lights Out movie that we saw?" And she's like, "We can go see that because she likes scary movies." But that's not the one you're talking about, Jake. Mm-hmm. They came out 1 or 2 weeks apart.
Yeah.
Anything stick out to you in this movie, like scenes or characters, like I asked you last time?
The blind man had more personality than a lot of killers in these movies do.
Yeah.
Without saying much.
Yeah.
At all. You kind of feel for him in the beginning. Like you said, you rooted for him. I think your opinion will change by the end of the movie.
Mine didn't.
Okay. Sicko.
Yeah, I'm sorry, but these kids deserved to die.
These kids, I don't know if they deserve to die, but they deserve some punishment of some kind.
I said partway through the movie that you could probably have put Clint Eastwood in the same role, but then everyone would have been on my page of being like, oh, I'm going to root for the good, the bad guy.
I said, when you said that in the movie, I was like, well, I think Clint Eastwood turned it down. And then they got, well, let's get Stephen Lang.
Yeah.
He's not doing anything. But yeah, that's that. And yeah, the stupidity of the main characters and some of the scenes, which is to be expected in a scary movie like this, to be kind of dumb. But yeah, there's a lot of jump scares, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing really got me jumping, except for that dog.
The dog at the beginning, that was the very first one.
Yeah.
And it was, usually you have the music to cue you up, like a, you know.
Yeah, it was.
There was none. it was just all of a sudden it happened. The one thing that I will gripe, and I'm really picking at this to gripe about this, no spoilers here, but any death that did happen in the movie, I called about 5 to 10 seconds before the death happened, and everyone, even though they were kind of supposed to each one be like, boom, out of nowhere, each one I did know exactly when it was.
One of the trailers I saw implied that death.
Well, that was, I mean, that implied death, I think, helped the trailer, and it put butts in seats, because it made it more like, oh, this guy's willing, he's going to murder all these people here. Because near the beginning of the movie, semi-spoiler, all right, here it is, 1, 2, 3, the kid that you care the least about dies. He straight up gets murdered by the dude.
The only character I remember his name, surprisingly.
Money, yeah. Right? Yeah. He gets killed because it makes the viewer, it puts them into the notion that, oh, these kids are
endangered,
against a guy that's much, much more, scary than they thought he would be. Cause when they broke into the house at the beginning, they're like, it's a blind guy.
It's a blind
old man.
He's
old and he's not gonna be able to do anything. No, this is the same character from Avatar that's just blind now. And he's been blind forever, and he knows where everything in his house is, better than they even do. So where are you going to rate this one?
You go ahead and go first.
Man, I think it's hard to rate a scary movie or a suspense movie when you live in a world with drama, and movies like Kubo that I saw. I did see this before.
Definitely opposite ends of the spectrum.
Right.
These two movies.
So, I'm going to say, if I'm just looking at this from a suspense horror movie standpoint, I give it a 4 out of 5 in a suspense horror movie genre. Does that make sense? If you have a gripe against the way I'm rating it, I guess, crucify me in the comments. But, 4.
I was thinking a 4, and without any of that extra crap.
Right on.
It was an hour and a half.
Oh, yeah. Perfect
length.
It's
a short movie, but it was perfect length for this movie.
Yeah.
A movie doesn't have to be a 3-hour epic to be good.
Right.
This movie was great, and it was an hour and a half.
Especially this type of movie, because you can't go 2.5 hours in that kind of suspense. After a while, you'll either get sick of it, or you'll be like sick and I'm done seeing this much suspense. I want to go home and go to bed.
And like you said, it wasn't a gory movie. I'm glad that directors are realizing that people are kind of sick of the torture porn that's out.
Yeah.
Like Saw. I like Saw a lot. Hostel. Those movies were great when they came out, but you can't oversaturate the market with that kind of stuff and expect.
Because we can become numb to it.
Yeah.
There was a really gross scene in there. We're not saying it's just completely free of gross things that happen, but. There is, beware that there is at least one scene.
And if you're easily triggered, probably don't go see it either.
Yeah. Trigger warning. So that's going to do it for this week for Nerd Buffet. We saw such good things this week. Between Stranger Things, I watched it. I think I started it Tuesday night after SmackDown. I started watching it. I got about 2 or 3 episodes in that night. And I finished it off Thursday right after we watched Don't Breathe. We actually started the first, like, 15 minutes of it, the last episode, went and saw Don't Breathe with you. Remember I was saying, like, oh, God, I want to see what happens
at the end. It was up to the end. Yeah, you're like, I almost don't want to see this movie.
And then we rushed home afterwards. Well, we did stop at McDonald's because fat. But after McDonald's, we went home and finished up Stranger Things and went to bed happy with the way it ended. It was really cool. Of course, there were little beats that do set up for next season. I was hoping with the way it was ending that it didn't end too happy, because then that would have left the possibility of like creating a new cast with the monster, you know, elsewhere. Yeah.
You really want to see what happens with those characters.
I'm in love with all the characters. Yeah. Yeah. But between seeing Stranger Things, of course, Don't Breathe on Thursday, and then last night going and seeing Kubo, we have three great recommendations that are all over the scale on types. I mean, we have a sci-fi there, we have a horror thriller, and then we have like a family movie. If you're gonna watch one, though, in my opinion, it's gonna be Kubo, and that's what I'm gonna say. Please, Tom, go watch Kubo since you've seen the other two. Man, just such good things. Anything that you're interested in seeing coming up soon, or anything on Netflix that you're gonna watch?
There's nothing out that's really I want to see. There's a movie that's out. I saw it in Redbox the other day called The Lobster.
Oh yeah, you told me about that.
I really want to see that movie. It's probably not very good because it didn't come out in theaters around here. Mm-hmm. But it's supposedly about a guy who goes to this resort that if you don't fall in love at the resort, you have to get turned into an animal. And so he chooses to be a lobster when he signs in. Like, the trailer's like, which animal would you like to be? He's like, I'd like to be a lobster.
So you have to throw it out up front. Yeah. That, like, if I don't fall in love, I'll be a lobster.
Yeah.
That's cool.
So
it sounds really indie. Like, the idea.
I think it was, to be sure.
But I'd be, if you want to watch it, I'd be willing to meet up and watch it with you.
But that's the only thing. I mean, there's nothing really come out in the theaters that I really have to see or want to see, you know.
My recommendation for you this week, then, is going to be we watched the first couple episodes before we started this. Have you started to like Ballers at all?
From it's HBO? Good. I don't have HBO. I'll have to steal yours and watch it. But.
Okay. We're not HBO. We're not doing that because I think that's now like against.
Oh, it's some illegal. Sort of
law.
Illegamos.
But he's definitely not using my thing to watch it.
Nope.
So next week we were really thinking about, if you get the time to watch it, definitely watch Ballers, and we could talk about that next week, at least season one, because season two is now, I think, 5 episodes in. I don't really remember how many episodes were on season one. It wasn't very long. I did watch it all in one day, like after work, because I, like, 30-minute episodes and just zoomed through. That being said, I want to do kind of, since the summer's at an end and we're kind of getting into the crap fest, at least till
Christmas time.
Well, at least till Thanksgiving time.
Yeah.
Because I, as much as people are saying and hating on the first movie and saying that the second one's going to suck, Thanksgiving, the day before Thanksgiving, Bad Santa 2 comes out. Billy Bob Thornton, which, of course, he's not a really reliable source, but he says this. He's saying this movie is funnier and dirtier than the first movie.
He may be biased.
He may be a little bit biased, but it does have. It did feature in the first trailer the best part about the first movie, the kid, and like they're keeping him the exact same. It looks like he has the exact same like undersized shirt on, and he has the same haircut and everything. So that one is one of those movies that what's the word for that when no one likes it but you? Actually, I might say it's kind of a cult movie in a way.
Yeah, I don't think you're the only one that likes it. But
a lot of people
hate on it. I thought it was good. Comedies aren't really my forte, yeah. But
it's wholly quotable through the whole movie. The kid, at the very least, is completely quotable. One of the last movies with, what's the dude from Problem Child and John Lithgow? Is that who I'm thinking of?
The Trinity Killer?
No, not John Lithgow. Jesus, why am I thinking of him? Jesus, I'm going to be mad at myself for forgetting his name. He was the store clerk, like the manager of the mall. And like he would hated bad words and hated any sort of talk a sec. He was complete.
I don't remember him.
There are two dead people in that movie. Bernie Mac was a big role in the movie, and John Ritter. That's who I'm thinking
John
of.
John Ritter.
You remember John Ritter?
Yeah.
We're there. They kind of played opposite roles in that show. So maybe we've got some roles to fill in with the second one. I really don't want to spend a lot of time until we see the movie, because it's not that prestigious of a movie to be talking about and wasting our time on.
No.
But also during Thanksgiving time, in November at least, we have Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
That looks fantastic as well. So he's from now to then,
Sorcerer Supreme,
and a Chicken Supreme,
yeah,
Burrito Supreme, a Cutlass Supreme,
Cutlass Supreme.
Okay. So we do have things to look forward to. I don't know if I said it because I just really rambled on there for about 5 minutes about stuff that's coming out. But what I want to do is, with this end of summer and the Crap Fest coming on, talk about so far what are our favorite things that have come out this year.
This year or this summer?
Let's do summer.
Okay.
Because we'll, at the end of the year, we'll do a top of the entire year. Hint, hint, Kubo is going to be on my list. And I hope if Tom sees it by next week, it's on his too. I don't have a whole lot more to say for this week, but I'm really excited to talk to you about what my favorite movies were this summer. So for now, I've been Jake.
And I'm Tommy. And our princess is in another castle.
Oh, this is always my least favorite time of the week. When the video ends, that means I have to go to bed and get ready for work in the morning.
It's okay, Jake, because you could always subscribe to the YouTube channel and be alerted every time the new videos come out.
Really?
Yes, you could also like the channels and follow us on Twitter at Real Nerd Buffet, and get on Facebook and follow us.
What? Oh my god, I'm gonna do it right away! And you should too! I'm sorry. Shit.